So let's start with the video quiz and then we'll see how it flows. I told you it was a short video. Now let's get into the quiz. It's not hardcore legal. It is about films, books, a few of the legal sections, 10 questions. Raise your hand if you know the answer. It's an objective, so you have choices. The first five get 5 books. I don't have any more books to give, so if you know the answer, be right in the first times. Could we have the first question, please? What was the name of the Hindi film based on the 1956 award-winning Hollywood film 12 Angry Men? We have an answer. There you go.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So, second question. The shortened Latin legal term et al. Means? There you are. It is commonly used wrongly as the following thing. It is for the common people. Legally speaking, you can use it interchangeably with etc. It works. Who penned the legal thriller Presumed Innocent and its sequel Innocent? Scott Turow, John Grisham, or James Patterson? Anybody else? I didn't know you were participating, but here you are. No, the answer is not on the computer, so he has done his job well. Well, you had a lot of choices, so it was only Scott Turow left. And it is also a film, and Harrison Ford stars in The Presumed Innocent. It's worth watching. The recent Hindi film Rustam was based on a true story. We all know that. The same true story was used in Vinod Khanna starrer Mere Apne Man Ki Meet Achanak. There you go. I think it's a bit too easy, isn't it? You're welcome. Fifth question. The abbreviation IE, which means that is, comes from science, law, or maths? Well, that was easy. No more books to give away. But we can still have the 5 more questions. At a crime scene, who can legally declare a person dead? A doctor, a police officer? Doctor. Next one. In India, how long does a person have to be missing to be presumed 7? See, it was easy. Which one of these countries does not have a written constitution? United Kingdom, UK. Section 420 of the Indian Penal Code, it was quite a giveaway. Agatha Christie's Hercule Poirot was a lawyer, a private detective. There you go. Everyone knew all the answers. So that was the quiz. So I have a book and I have jotted some notes at the back of the envelope, literally. So, crime fiction. Now, crime fiction is a broad spectrum. You could write it from the perspective of the doer, so the criminal. Where if you've read the books or you've seen the movies, it would be anti-hero, or as the Americans would call it, anti-hero. So two of my books are basically from the perspective of the doer. It's not that I'm trying to glamorize them, but they too have a story to tell. Now you could have crime fiction from the perspective of the investigator. So it could be a private investigator like Poirot. It could be a police detective, which I've created is Rita Ferreira. She's supposedly DCP Rita Ferreira. She starred in Bhendi Bazaar, she starred in Dusra, and the one that I'm currently writing called Lipstick, she stars in that as well. So it's a series. Or it could be a journalist. So sometimes it's investigative journalism that catches. However, that brings us to the third point, which I was trying to say about legal fiction, that the police can go and arrest a person, but they can't, and that would be an accused. Till a court of law in any country convicts a person, the accused does not become a criminal. And that is where legal fiction comes in, which sadly, it is not a new genre as it's said over here. It's a new genre in India. And like I was telling the crowd yesterday, it is one of those genres where, except outside of US, very few authors have written legal fiction, which kind of brings you to the point, why did they miss the boat? And I'll tell you, if you ever been to a courtroom, you'll realize that the courtroom has to be an interesting place to play a game. A courtroom has accommodation for audience, which means people go there to enjoy the miseries of other people. Have you ever seen a kind of a auditorium when you go to see a doctor, that all other guys wait and see what are you being diagnosed at? They do not have an auditorium in a police station. A courtroom is designed to give you thrill. So a courtroom fiction will automatically become a thriller, provided it is taken and kind of written, the narrative kind of speaks to it. Again, in a courtroom thriller, you can play the three parts of being the criminal, the arresting guy who sees that his arrest has gone waste, or being the legislator who actually convicts the guy. I don't know how many of you have seen a film called Fracture. It's by Anthony Hopkins, and the poster says, "I killed my wife, prove it." And the first scene, he actually shoots his wife, calls the police, admits that he's killed his wife, and then when he goes to court, he changes and says, "I never killed her. They forced me to give them a statement, and I admitted to it because they were kind of beating me or pushing me, but I never killed her. Now try proving how it is." And even in Presumed Innocent that we were talking about earlier, it is a legal story where Harrison Ford is accused of murdering his girlfriend, his mistress, and how he gets away. I'm not going to take the suspense away whether he is actually the doer or not. And then a sequel that Scott Turow wrote 13 years later, which was Innocent, where he was accused of killing his wife. And it's a story that he's kind of taken across 13 years. Same judge accused of, he was a judge, Harrison Ford, accused of killing his mistress who used to work for him. And 13 years later, accused of killing his wife in similar circumstances. And both times, whether he's guilty or he's innocent, I'm not going to spoil the surprise for you. What else can I tell you about crime fiction? I would have to struggle. So I have 6 books. Sadly, only one of them is available here, which is Unlawful Justice, which I started with the idea that all crimes are not sins, and all sins are not crimes. So I can give you an example that if you were 3 of you on a motorcycle, it's a crime by law, but it is no longer, it's not a sin. Taking it a little away, and I'm not proposing or saying this is right, adultery is not a crime. Adultery is just a sin. Sin if you believe in God or Jesus or anyone. So they are 2 separate things which people kind of think that justice means that something is right. Justice for a lot of people is pure vengeance, because that is exactly what you're doing. You're asking a third party, because you are victimized, you're asking a third party to intervene on your behalf to penalize the person who's done the crime. So that is legal fiction. Unlawful Justice, it's a story of a girl who works in a rich household who gets raped by somebody else who is a visitor to the house. It so happens that the household is friendly with the people who visit, and there is an argument between husband and wife because the wife wants to prosecute the, when they figure out who it is. It is the husband's most richest, biggest client's son, and the husband doesn't want to do that. He says, let's get a payoff. And that's how the story kind of, it's a moral dilemma for a family. Where do you go from here? Do you actually take the victim to the court and run through the whole array of feelings? Because bear it in mind, a courtroom does not mean that truth will win. The best argument will win. The defense and the prosecution are given the same set of witnesses. It's a very interesting line. Sadly, I could never complete my law. I'm a dropout. But it's like a game of chess. Both players have exactly the same pawns and the pieces. You have the exact number of witnesses. You have the same story, because a person came here, murdered, killed, raped, whatever. It's how you tell a judge your story. One story wins over the other. So that's legal fiction. My next book is also a legal fiction, which is a story of one of the richest guys in India who is accused of killing his ex-wife and her husband, and they take him to court. nothing more than that. After that, I have a heist story where, I don't know how many of you are aware, there is a particular Van Gogh painting which has actually been stolen twice. It's called Poppy Flowers. The second time it went missing, it is from an Egyptian museum. So I have fictionally based that painting in India. It's somewhere in India. Because I did acknowledge in the end that I could have made up a painting, I could have made up a price. But if the truth is so stranger than fiction, why not use the truth? And it's the whole story is from the perspective of the person who has to steal it and then supply it to a Japanese buyer. So that's the two big things in the pipeline. I guess that's, we should also let the other guy, any questions I'm willing to take.
Any questions for Fish?
Any questions for me? But I was very clear.
Is there another microphone here?
Yeah. Yeah.
So I am an aspiring writer and I've been thinking of going to the police station and doing research for some story. Do you do that?
I didn't go to the police station to do it, but I have friends in the police. One of my brother-in-laws is the commissioner of police for Gurgaon, so I have ready access to information. In fact, on this trip, I have the privilege of going and visiting a jail. Not actually being kind of handcuffed and taken in, but yeah. But that's what it, I, one of my stories kind of covers inside the jail. In Mumbai, there's a jail where you have a solitary cell called Anda cell. So unless you know the details about it, you can't describe it. So I would recommend if you find some contacts to go and have a look and then word it of what you've seen. It'll come out much more realistically.
And do you spend a lot of time in the courthouse also listening to...
I don't. No. I don't spend time in the courthouse, but there are enough films, enough books and enough television series that you know how a courthouse functions. And then it's just a question of elaborating because every case is different. The scene remains the same. So you have a prosecutor, how they sit. You have a defense lawyer, how they sit. The judge sits where. The court clerk sits where. And where the audience is, the defense table. And the so that's largely a given. Now it's the case and the details and the manipulations of the law. So which means I read a lot of law books. I read a lot of law cases to kind of then...
Hello, sir. You said that since you deal with crime stories, you said that people perceive adultery as a sin and other crime stories are not crime. In real life situations, how do you draw a thin line between what is a sin and what is a crime?
Well, see, this is a question that got asked the other day as well. But as a novelist, especially as a crime fiction novelist, I wouldn't like to cause a titillating situation if it is a crime rape. However, I'm at the heart of it an entertainer. You do not pick up a fiction, crime fiction, like a moral science. So I have a little bit of leverage as to how I want to play. I didn't say adultery is a sin. Adultery could be a sin.
People perceive like that. That is what you said.
Yeah.
So how do you draw a thin line between in real life stories is what my question is to you. So because
I'm at a loss at answering that one. Because fictionally, you can answer that.
Yeah.
In real life, I guess each one is bound by their own kind of upbringing. And, you know, your set of morals might not be my set of morals and vice versa.
Yeah.
So what you might perceive as wrong might be perfectly all right in other people's cases. What I perceive as wrong might be perfectly okay for you. So it's everybody is guided by their own moral kind of upbringing that they've had from school, from the neighborhood. And believe you me, when I was younger, the set of things I believed in, have now I look back and ask the questions back at my parents as to why do you think this is right?
Uh-huh.
I'm not saying the absolutely right of committing adultery, but a lot of things we were taught is as your experience grows, as you mature, you ask questions, and that is what all humans do. Because if we did not explore our thumbs way back in the jungles, we would still be jumping around in branches. Because we discovered thumbs, we realized we were humans, we could do a lot more. So I guess it's a process of maturity. I know I can't answer you absolutely black and white because the question is a bit...
I get it.
There is no right or wrong answer to that, to be fair.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Would I be right in saying that... legal fiction begins where crime fiction ends. The ending of a crime fiction is probably the beginning of legal fiction. in the sense that it has to, you know, the crime has to be established in a courtroom. One more follow-up question. Do you think the Indian legal system or the courtroom setting does not lend itself to being the subject of fiction as much as probably the American legal system? Because is that one of the reasons for the legal fiction genre not being that popular as it is in the US?
Yeah, but that eliminate, what you're saying is that because, sorry, I'm answering the second question first. The legal system in UK is perfectly working. Actually, the legal system in India is working perfectly as well. The problem we have here is that the courtrooms were designed, the recruitments happened for 1,000 people and 10,000 turned up. So that kind of has a strain on the infrastructure. So the population, because we have so many cases pending in the courts of law, and that is why the delay happens, the court functionality of what I know works perfectly fine. It's just that the delay happens because the number of people taking the decisions, the number of judges, the number of lawyers are in proportion very less. Your first question, it's a yes and a no. So yes, the crime has to happen for it to go to court. So yes, it is a start. The ending of crime is the starting of legal. However, in a legal fiction, when I have to write, I have to devote pages or some time elaborating on the crime as well. Because if you start right on the court case, then you might have to build a flashback to explain to the reader why the case is brought to the court. So there would be elements of crime in the beginning that would make the reader's mind up whether you want to empathize with the prosecution, whether you want to go with the justice, whether you want to go with the defense. So I guess it's a rolling ball.
So when you write this, do you work backwards, like where you know how you're going to solve it and work backwards to fit in all the, you know, all the pieces of the puzzle, or go as the puzzles go and then build the ending? How do you work towards it?
When I start writing, and which is different from anybody you ask, if you ask Mr. Pathak, I don't know if you've read Surendra Mohan Pathak, he's one of the biggest crime writers. He's written 500 books in Hindi. Or you ask Ravi Subramanyam, who's my peer, and I obviously always have the beginning of what the crime is going to be, what is the kind of hook to the story, and how it will get solved. Once I have those two things, I start filling the pages. Obviously, as I go into the story, the subplots happen. I kind of figure out, oh, there can be another murder here. Sometimes the murder is to keep the story interesting. Sometimes it is to provide a clue to the reader, because I do not believe in the old, Agatha Christie is the queen. There's no question about it. But the way people have started reading, they want to be given clues so that they can figure out as to who the actual doer, what is the crime, and it's always a race against the author. And I always give clues, enough clues to people that if they miss, when they look back, they'll know we missed the clue. So I always give clues. And sometimes for clues, I have sub-stories, subplots, to give at least the personality or the character of a person for you to figure out this can be it.
Any more questions? Vish, why don't you read an excerpt from your book?
Okay, I can. So, unlawful justice starts like this. He shouldn't have been there. Maheep Singh shouldn't have been where he was that fateful afternoon. But he was. He was 18, spoilt rotten by his parents, particularly by his doting mother, Jaya. Not that his father, Maninder Singh, ever really truly endeavored to stop his wife from indulging the male heir. Born after three daughters, daughters were supposed to be reined in. But the son was exempt from any and all discipline. The immunity from his parents, coupled with the unaccounted wealth accumulated from equally unmentionable sources by his father, though envied by his friends, made him like the allegedly impermeable Titanic racing towards the iceberg. So what I'm trying to say is, I am not, as I said, writing moral science, but there is this takeout, which was brought up in a review very well, that it is a lot up to parents in their upbringings, how they bring up their kids. So the entire, I'm not making this up. We had, when the big rape happened in Delhi, there was some minister who had the gall to stand up and say that this is happening because women are eating Chinese noodles. Now, how is eating Chinese noodles kind of subject you to rape? So what women wear, So the whole thing is about we as a society, not just India, we as a society have always put inhibitions on women. We have never ever thought that it is our upbringing of the sons that is more important than the women, of what women wear, where women go, what women do. Everybody has the same right. So that is the, if there is a moral. I don't believe in moral science. This is entertainment, fiction. So
Vish, your stories, six novels you said, are all based in the Indian culture, or is it, migrant?
It is all based in Mumbai and Delhi.
So your, obviously each story, I mean, each novel has a different subject that you have taken, a different kind of crime,
different
I would
kind
say.
Of
crime. And telling of, you're almost like picking out what is wrong with the Indian, the social fabric, so to say.
Not necessarily. The social fabric, we kind of, I've traveled, I've lived abroad. It's a very homogeneous world. The kind of, temptations, the kind of behavior. Okay, it differs a bit from India to England. But it differs a bit from Bangalore to Ajmer. People have the same kind of upbringings. It's quite similar. It's not taking out faults of a fabric. And I don't, because crime happens everywhere. In fact, I was talking to my brother-in-law, my Salah, who is the commissioner. India has a higher rate of catching criminals than the UK. Because of whatever reasons, we have better police machinery. We already know where it's going to happen. We know the people who are going to do it. But India has a higher rate in closing crime rates than a lot of developed Western countries. So, and court cases, as I said, it's again a question of numbers. So if you have judges that are equipped to handle 1,000 cases and you bring 10,000, it is going to fault. It's the same thing with any infrastructure. So if you if you're supplying water for 10 people and 100 turn up, they will people who will go thirsty. So, and crime happens regardless. Crime pays. I'm not saying I'm doing it or it will pay you, because it will at some point ask you for back. But it's going to happen, because there are laws, there are people, there are temptations, there are people who have greed, there are people who have different upbringings, who do not, different consciences, different morals. Still, they are psychopaths, which they do for without a reason, a random reason, serial killer. Or something in their background or something in their upbringing has gone wrong. So serial killers are basically born because they have seen something bad in the past. So it will always be dark. So it's going to happen. You cannot eliminate crime from this world. It's never
going to
happen.
True. But I'm thinking if you, it is, it's a more, not so much discovered in India as yet. But to take on something that is very peculiar or typical of an Indian social scene, where certain crime against women, like child marriage or the dowry system. And if you could, I would find it really interesting to read a book that, deals with these crimes. Female infanticide.
I'll be fair. I mean,
the current Indian judicial system that we have, so it would like be so deeply rooted in the continent, in the subcontinent, that probably a different avenue.
Well, if I do find a case, so as I said, I do go. Anybody can go on IndianKanoon.com, and all the cases that have had a verdict, and you are allowed to have a read of those cases. And if I find a case interesting enough, which can be, because the case is a page long, you've got to fictionalize it with the entire kind of flowers around it, more characters added into it, how the defense played their cards, how the prosecution played their cards. If I find it interesting enough, I will pick it up. I'm not going to be looking over my shoulder as to what people think. If I find it, it will be there.
Any more questions?
Hi, I just wanted to get a sense. You see yourself writing about financial crimes and crimes on the corporate law side, because much of the writing I see is more corporate crimes, and I see a lot happening in the financial crime side, like Rajat Bhatia and security scams and things like that. So, but somehow don't really see much work that's being done to fictionalize that and bring that and make that more easy to the audience? So just sort of trying to get a sense of...
We have two very big authors in India who write on financial crimes. Ravi Subramaniam is one of them. R.V. Raman is one of them. They are absolutely fantastic. If you, Ravi is out of this league, so is R.V. Raman. Both of them do corporate financial kind of crime. And as I said, I'm not bound by what crime it is. If I like the plot has to come in my head. It's not, I can't steal somebody's plot. So if I find a plot which is into financial crime, I mean, Bob's my uncle then. I'll go and do that. Or I have at the moment only written crime fiction and people kind of, if I find a plot, I've been kind of wondering on it. I could branch out on something else. I mean, nothing say. So two of my books are actually romantic suspense. So there is an element of romance underlying the crime there. Or maybe it has led to crime. So I don't know which way I'll write. What I know what is in the pipeline. I don't know what I'll write next. So.